welcome to this edition, hopefully with audio again, of Wake and Bake News. Yesterday was a big surprise to me. My audio actually was working. I don't understand. What am I touching? Makes this work. Apparently it's not the video lag that's a tip to when the audio's gonna mess up. And I have no clue if the audio's messing up when I make these. And then it takes about an hour to convert them from the flash file to media file. And then it's like takes me almost an hour and a half to find out if the thing is okay or not, you know. Oh, it's such a process. So I'm trying to do tests. Remember to go back to doing tests before I start my show. Little short tests to make sure the audio is working so I don't get surprised like that. And hopefully my test this morning is going to show that the audio is working. So hello and welcome to this edition of Wake and Bake News with your host, Shampoo VTA, Kelly Davis. And today I have something to show you. I got re-upped with some Smart OG from Smart Meds this weekend. Oh, and then my stuff's in there. Oop, there you go. Just block that door. Boop, boop, boop. Wrinkly fingers. Let's move the ancient hand. Hey. Actually, I really like the wrinkly finger look. I used to love that on my grandmother. I used to touch my grandmother's veins when I was a little girl. Like, I was about six. I was fascinated by her veins. And I would sit there for hours. Her skin was so soft. And my great-grandmother, great-great-grandmother, great-grandmother. And I would just sit there. She passed away when I was, like, about seven. I adored her. She used to braid my hair and read me stories. Smart OG. So let's load some. First, we better test its strength. Let's see what the reading is. Oh, yes, it's good. It's good medication. It's not, it hasn't been tampered with by the Daleks. It's good medication. I want a tricorder. That would be funny to do it with a tricorder. Nope. There it is. Okay, so let's take a look at the news this morning first. Take the da-da-da off. Go to monitor capture. Got some things ready this morning and not other things. SwearNet! That's a great painting. That looks awesome. Trailer Park Boys. We love watching the Trailer Park Boys. Come on, you. Let's start out with Mr. Christie today. Make sure everything's good, yeah. The best part of waking up, marijuana in your bowl. now with new and improved flavor. No. Now with a new and improved high. What in the blue blazes is taking this thing so long to load? Jiminy Christmas. Okay. Let's wait till it's finished with its spinning and everything. Make sure everything is okay. All right. Chris Christie calls marijuana users diseased, pledges to cure them with law enforcement. He could be cured with Jenny Craig. While delivering a speech on Thursday, New Jersey governor and presidential hopeful Chris Christie doubled down on his anti-marijuana agenda, referring to marijuana users as diseased. Governor Christie reiterated his ambitions to crack down and not permit marijuana use, even in states where the practice is legal. As NewJersey.com reports, Christie has pledged that if elected, he would have all of those diseased people in place, like Colorado, treated by armed federal agents. What a bedside manner. Chris Christie has a long track record of promoting marijuana prohibition, so these remarks are not exactly surprising. In 2014, Christie traveled to Colorado, where he criticized voters' decision to legalize marijuana 2 years prior, claiming the new policy diminishes the quality of life in the states. If elected president, Christie plans to crack down on legal marijuana on the basis that federal law supersedes state law. We need to send very clear leadership from the White House on down through the federal law enforcement. Marijuana is an illegal drug under law, and the states should not be permitted to sell it and profit from it. Christie is also a staunch opponent of medical marijuana, which he considers a front for legalization, and only allowed tightly restricted use of medical marijuana. I can't take it seriously. So it's just ridiculous. New Jersey, after a very public lobby campaign that pitted him against a father of a little girl, according to CNN. When it comes to marijuana policy, Chris Christie is on the wrong side of history. His position on the issue appeal to a rapidly shrinking minority of voters, according to nationwide polls. Most Americans support legalizing marijuana, and 81% think it should be legal for medical purposes. Perhaps more importantly for Christie, 64% of Americans are against the federal government's taking steps to enforce federal anti-marijuana laws in states where marijuana is legal, according to a Gallup poll conducted in 2012. And I think that really is the point. He's showing he's not a states' rights guy, isn't he? He's telling everybody, psh, I don't believe in states' rights. By persistently promoting his anti-marijuana position, Chris Christie is shooting himself in the foot. Like he didn't do that with Bridgegate. I mean, what has he got to lose? As other GOP candidates have come to realize, these changes in public opinion are too significant to ignore. The approach of Bush, Senators Rand Paul and Ted Cruz, and others involve expressing an antipathy for marijuana use, but supporting the right of states to make their own policies about it, even if their laws contradict federal status. Christie is running as the second coming of Nixon, which may explain his poor performance in the polls. Most of the GOP contenders have migrated back to the traditional Republican belief in the states as laboratories of democracy. He could do.
I'm not a crook. I did not close that bridge.
Yeah, his hands are almost right there. Just do this, man, and you're on it. It's like a time machine. They're right. He is the second coming of Nixon. old school silly hardball politics.
Alright, this is how we're gonna run things.
10 reasons why federal medical marijuana prohibition is about to go up in smoke. When I first opened the DC Office for Americans for Safe Access, ASA, in 2006, to bring representation of medical marijuana patients to our nation's capital, I was told by many it was not worth the effort. A quick skim of the political landscape back then showed we would be facing a steep slope. Sure, 12 states had passed medical marijuana laws, and 80% of Americans support medical cannabis access, but the federal government refuses to admit that medical cannabis patients existed. The talking points from federal agencies were always, there is no such thing as medical marijuana, and most members of Congress were paralyzed by fear of backlash or were dug into a reefer madness. Flash forward 9 years and $500,000 of anti-medical cannabis federal enforcement later, and the first time we have comprehensive medical marijuana legislation in both the House and Senate, the Compassionate Access Research Expansion and Respect States Act, the CARES Act, of 2015, is the most comprehensive piece of federal medical marijuana legislation ever introduced into the U.S. Congress. The Bipartisan Act is sponsored in the Senate by Senator Cory Booker and Senator Rand Paul and Senator Christine Gillibrand, and in the House of Representatives by Steve Cohen and Representative Don Young. The important bill will remedy the state's federal conflict over medical marijuana laws with far-reaching impacts, including allowing state programs to continue without federal enforcement, moving marijuana out of a Schedule I list, removing CBD from the scheduling, creating access to banks, services for legal marijuana businesses, ending the DEA's imposed NIDA monopoly that blocks research, allowing veterans affairs doctors to write recommendations in states that have medical marijuana programs. 9 years ago, even I might have been pessimistic about passing a comprehensive marijuana reform bill through Congress, but as previously impossible victories keep mounting, I am confident we can do this. Here's why, not in any particular order. Congress passes ceasefire amendment in the federal war on medical marijuana with bigger majorities each year. For 18 years, the federal government wasted millions of dollars in interfering with states' medical marijuana laws. Last year, with the passage of the Rockenbacher-Farr Medical Cannabis Amendment to the CJS Appropriations Bill, we were able to win a full vote in the House of Representatives by a margin of 219 to 189. To end this pointless waste of resources, the amendment essentially barred the Department of Justice from spending money to target medical marijuana patients and providers who are following state laws. However, being an appropriations amendment, it needs to be reauthorized every year. When the House of Representatives voted on Rockenbacher-Farr Medical Cannabis Amendment in June of this year, it passed with an overwhelming margin of 242 to 186. Later in June, under Senator Mikulski's leadership, the Senate Appropriations Committee also voted for an amendment with the language of Rohrabacher and Farr, excuse me, I'm trying to say his name right, medical cannabis amendments by a vote of 21-9. On both sides of the Hill, members of the Republican and Democratic parties are saying they want the federal government to level states, level medical marijuana programs alone, to level state-level medical marijuana programs alone. So 40 states, including Texas and Oklahoma, have passed medical marijuana. To date, 40 states have passed laws that allow for the medical use of marijuana in some form, with 275 million Americans living in states where medical cannabis is a treatment option. It's simply impossible to deny the federal law are drastically out of line with the will of the people and patients, as well as medical professionals across the country, who have come to realize the value of medical marijuana and demand their state legislator pass laws to provide access. The head of the National Institute of Drug Abuse says it's time to let more places grow marijuana for research. For years, the National Institute of Drug Abuse, NIDA, has been the only organization that grows marijuana for research, despite researchers saying this practice undermines their work. The Drug Enforcement Agency, DEA, has refused to issue licenses on other research centers. At a hearing last month, NIDA head Nora Volker indicated that she also supported letting other researchers' centers grow marijuana. At this point, it's only a matter of time before the DEA mandated NEDA monopoly on producing marijuana is a thing of the past. And that's that kindergarten playground size lot they have where they grow weed to test for research. And I'm like, that's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. That's a size. I've worked playgrounds bigger than that. It's like a soccer field. You gotta be kidding. The drug czar removes unnecessary burden to medical marijuana research. Last month, the Office of National Drug Control Policy, ONDCP, announced they had lifted the Public Health Service, PHS, review on marijuana research project. The PHS review has originally meant to facilitate marijuana research, but in practice has always slowed research projects by years, and without a doubt has deterred countless researchers. Like other reforms that weren't possible in years past, removing the PHS review happens with little to no controversy. Organ transplant protection passes with huge margins in California. One of our top priorities at ASA has been passing organ transplant protections in California. California has the nation's largest medical marijuana program, but sadly doesn't do enough to protect patients from civil discrimination because of outdated policies that lack any significant justification. Patients in California and elsewhere have been routinely removed from organ transplant waiting lists. Earlier this month, Governor Jerry Brown signed AB 258, which will end organ transplant discrimination in California. The California Assembly passed AB 258 by a margin of 52-8, which was followed by the Senate passing AB 258 by an even more overwhelming margin of 31-1. There is still a lot of work to be done to end civil discrimination against medical marijuana patients, but votes like these, including the passage of AB 258, shows that politicians from diverse ideology backgrounds are willing to vote protect law-abiding citizens. Willing to vote, protect law-abiding citizens. Willing to vote, okay. Senate votes to lift VA gag order on medical marijuana. In May, the U.S. Senate Committee on Appropriations voted by a margin of 18-12 to end the gag order that prevented Veteran Administration, VA, doctors from recommending or even discussing medical marijuana in states where medical marijuana programs exist. Many veterans have been demanding that VA doctors be given the same option as other doctors in medical marijuana states to use marijuana to treat PTSD. and the many potential health problems that veterans face. The Senate vote was the first time any medical marijuana issue was considered as the committee at a committee level, and its victory signaled that the Senate is ready to vote in favor of other medical marijuana protections. Federal agencies have changed their tone on medical marijuana. For years, NHTSA and FDA, the National Cancer Institute, and essentially every agency in the federal government all said the same thing about medical marijuana, that there was no such thing as medical marijuana. While state law slowly moved forward and more people became legal marijuana patients, the federal government's response stagnated. Today's agencies after agency has stopped ignoring medical marijuana and have even issued nuanced and detailed statements about medical marijuana. NHTSA's drug facts is marijuana medicine, FDA and marijuana questions and answers, and NCI's cannabis and cannabinoids unequivocally shows that federal agencies are grappling with the realities that millions of Americans are using medical marijuana instead of pretending medical marijuana is an issue that they can ignore. In fact, the DEA seems to be the last agency still espousing reefer madness in its publications. Well, we all know why that is. They wouldn't exist without it. Federal policies have changed, too. In 2008, federal policies on medical marijuana were non-existent in the eyes of federal governments. All marijuana use, possession, cultivation, and distribution were illegal. Today, several agencies have issued guidelines and other policies memorandums that are legitimate efforts to manage the emerging issue within medical marijuana, even if those efforts are often hamstrung by Congress's failure to pass legislation reforming marijuana laws. In 2014, the Treasury Department issued guidelines to facilitate banking in the marijuana industry. Before that, in 2010, the VA updated their policies to no longer deny veterans access to medical services due to their participation in state-level medical marijuana programs, starting in 2009. Ogaden memo, and later in 2013 by Deputy Attorney General James Cole, the Department of Justice has made clear that states' legal medical marijuana is not a priority. While these memos are merely non-binding guidance that can be ignored by federal prosecutors, there appears to have been a decline in prosecutions. The federal government's war on patients is drawing to a close. It is not completely over, and agencies are looking for a different path forward. Passing new laws is the only logical next step. Number 9, product safety standards and the cannabis monograph. Cannabis monograph. Okay, what does that mean? One of DEA's many excuses for not rescheduling medical marijuana is that we have not identified all the constituent components in the cannabis plant. In 2012, the American Herbal Pharmacopoeia created a cannabis monograph. Okay. A first-of-its-kind compendium of scientific data, including standards for the plant's identity, purity, quality, and botanical properties. The monograph provides a foundation in the for the cannabis to be regulated like any other herbal product in the U.S. Also, in 2012, the American Herbal Products Association created industry standards and recommendations for regulators in the areas of distribution, cultivation, analytics, and manufacturing, packaging, and labeling. This type of technical information simply did not exist 9 years ago, but now is being integrated in state-level laws across the country. We've proven that technical information exists and can be integrated in regulations that can assure public safety. Number 10, Senator Grassley and Feinstein call for medical marijuana research. Last week, we saw two longtime opponents of medical marijuana team up to say it's time we get serious about researching medical marijuana, Senators Charles Grassley, Republican, and Dianne Feinstein, Democrat of California, published an opinion piece in Time magazine asking to break down barriers to medical marijuana research. Senators Grassley and Feinstein were far from being considered allies of medical marijuana patients in the past, but even they have realized that federal policy is hurting patients like Malroy Minahan, whose father recently testified before the Senate committee about the difficulty of providing her with reliable medicine. While we'd like to see both Senator Grassley and Feinstein do more to help medical marijuana patients at the state-level program that provides them with much-needed medicine currently, their letters show unequivocal evidence that there is a growing recognition that the current policies aren't workable. And more is happening all the time. Today, ASA will be hosting a congressional briefing with Representatives Earl Blunerner, Democrat, Oregon, I guess, on ending federal barriers to medical marijuana research. At the briefing, Dr. Sue Sissel will present testimony on how federal barriers have directly blocked her research on using marijuana to treat post-traumatic stress disorder. Dr. David Kasseret, Associate Professor at the University of Pennsylvania, Perlman School of Medicine, and authority of the recently published book Stoned, A Doctor's Case for Medical Marijuana, will discuss contemporary medical marijuana research. The final speaker will be John Huddick, Fellow at Governance Study at the Brookings Institute and Manager Editor of the FinGov blog. Mr. Huddick will be discussing the often misunderstood impact of moving marijuana to a different scheduling classification under the Controlled Substance Act. It should go without saying that we need to help the health of committed citizens that want to see the new medical marijuana laws. ASA and other advocates have worked for years to lay the foundation that they have made the change mentioned above possible. But we need 85% of Americans that support medical cannabis to help us change federal laws once and for all. Click here for five things that you can do to help create safe access for medical marijuana this summer. Very good wrap-up of everything that's been happening. That was a very good, like summary, and encouraging summary, don't you think, stoners? This thing's wiggling, you know, of the events that have happened in just the last few months. Bergdahl found during raid at California pot farm. I guess this is someone who went AWOL. I was unaware of. Mendocino County, California. Former POW Bo Bergdahl was found in Mendocino County, California marijuana farm during a raid early this week, according to several reports. On Tuesday, the Haley native was visiting old friends at the farm, which is located in a remote part of Redwood Valley and Anderson Valley, According to AVA, Sergeant Bergdahl, who is awaiting military court-martial, had an army pass allowing him to be in Mendocino County. The Mendocino County Deputy Sheriff confirmed the report to NBC Bay Area, pardon me, stressing Bergdahl was not arrested during the raid. Yeah. Why don't you take the POW into cuffs? That would be great. Sheriff's official said that Bergdahl was on authorized leave to visit his friends and was not involved in with the production of marijuana. At the request of the Pentagon, Bergdahl was transported to Santa Rosa by the Sheriff's Department. According to NBC reports, an Army major was expected to take him to his duty station near Washington. In Haley, the Haley native, who is charged with desertion, was exchanged last year for five senior Taliban officials held at Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. Bergdahl preliminary hearing, which is similar to a civilian grand jury, is set for September. From there, his case could be referred for trial. How odd. What an odd story. I went to go visit somebody. Oh, that's funny. I'm famous for something else, but I got caught up in this. Oh, I won't read that one. Okay, this one I will read. Obama says that his biggest regret is that he didn't pass any gun laws. I think it's a lot harder to pass gun restrictions than people give. It's, you are messing with states' rights. You are going to have to consider that. But I think it is in the best interest of gun enthusiasts all over the country to try to keep guns out of the hands of people that shoot children, that shoot innocent people. This does not reflect well on you, whether you like it or not, whether it's fair or not. It is not, it's a reputation, and eventually it will be inescapable if this continues. Personally, I think they should take an active hand in trying to educate or prevent this from happening and not encourage mall cop behavior, basically. I am not against gun ownership. My father taught me to be very for the right to bear arms, but that kind of prohibition is ridiculous. But there are too many soft targets and too many crazy people that can get their hands on guns, and this does not reflect well on responsible gun owners. And responsible gun owners need to pull up their britches and come help us deal with this problem and stop talking about how it doesn't involve them. It's not a responsible way for adults to behave. Well, it's not my mess. I shouldn't have to clean it up. Well, then it's just going to stay there, isn't it? I don't think this problem gets solved until we do get them on our side. I think that is the whole key to this problem. Until we stop tearing at each other over the issue, we can't possibly face it together. Yeah. We're divided and conquered by our own opinions. Why Hillary Clinton can't just ignore marijuana in 2016. I love this picture of this young lady. This is so beautiful. Look how, like, happy she is. I have watched this fight since I was a young teenager, and we thought marijuana was going to be legalized. And we really, everybody, thought marijuana was going to be legalized. You know, and then it just disappeared from us, and it became the drug war and everything, and we became, you know, meddlers, and we're in mosh pits, and it just changed everything. It changed us. It changed everything. The minute we took that road, it made everything so much more violent and militaristic. Even the stoners, you know, were a little bit more rougher and edgier because of the drug war. It's so nice to see this come back. This just, hey, I'm out here, I'm healthy. Look at me. I'm not here with the chip on my shoulder. You know, I don't feel oppressed. I'm just here fighting for my rights. I think that's a beautiful image. I really do. It's just so nice to see things start to turn back to a healthier way of dealing with issues instead of this, that Chris Christie, you know, very goose steppy, doesn't turn out well kind of thing. Okay. On Thursday, Gallup released a poll showing that 44% of Americans have said they've tried marijuana. And half, her husband. Her husband is in that percentage. Okay, 44% of Americans have tried marijuana. The largest number the survey has ever recorded. This isn't too far off from what other polls have found. This Pew Research Center pegged the number at 49%. And given that people are being asked to admit to behavior that is illegal in most places, the true number is almost certainly higher. So we're past the point where most American adults have tried pot, which helps explain why support for legalization has also become a majority position in 2016, where we will be multiple legalization initiatives. There will be multiple legalization initiatives on state ballots, which could help drive turnout for Democrats and make the election of Hillary Clinton more likely, even if she's not a legalization supporter herself. You can think about this as a tipping point, but it was going to happen eventually. Chances are that your grandmother never smoked pot simply because it wasn't part of her culture in her youth. So she never had the opportunity. As older generations die off, they're replaced by those who have more direct experience with it. You know, I have to honestly say, stop right there. If that's the entire point to us dying. If you want to know the mystery of why humans die, it's because evolution, you know. Because if we don't die, and we don't die off quickly, then evolution will take freaking forever. And for us, we're adaptable. I think that's why our lifespan is as such. And we're pushing it, you know, further up because we can change our evolution with other means now besides dying. We can do it in other ways now with technology, maybe, instead of, you know, killing off a bunch of us and having babies until we get the right one. Let's see. Chances are your grandmother never smoked pot simply because it wasn't part of her culture in her youth. So she never had the opportunity. As older generations die off, they're replaced by those who have more direct experience with it. While only 22% of those over 65 in Gallup's data report having tried marijuana, 49% of those between 50 and 64 have. As have 50% of those between 30 and 49 only. 37% of those between 18 and 29 have tried it, presumably because it's the summer and many of the 18-year-olds haven't gotten to college yet. Kidding, sort of. As there used to be a saying, there's a time and a place, and it's called college. At the very least, people who smoked pot at some point probably realized that it didn't immediately send them off to score some heroin, so they're likely to be more open to the idea of legalization than those for whom it's utterly foreign. And it's millennials who are most strongly in favor of losing the laws, 68% of them in the Pew poll. Those in the legalization movement are counting on those people turning out in a presidential election year to push initiatives like the ones that legalized cannabis in Colorado, Washington, and Oregon, while organizers are still plotting strategies and preparing petitions in many states. At the moment, it looks like there could be legalization initiatives on the ballot in 2016 in Arizona, Massachusetts, Maine, Nevada, Missouri, and the big prize, California. California already has a medical marijuana system, which pretty much everyone agrees is a farce. Let's just say it isn't hard to find a doctor who will prescribe you pot for earlobe pain or fear of squirrels. And it would be a shock if voters there didn't approve a legalized system. Both Democrats and marijuana advocates are hoping there will be a turnout synergy at work. The initiative will bring out young people who are more likely to vote Democrat after they check the box for cannabis. And the higher Democratic turnout that a presidential year allows produces will make always produces will make the marijuana initiatives more likely to prevail. That would help Democrats running for any office, and in a couple of those states, it could provide a boost to Hillary Clinton if she's the nominee. Unlike her husband, who tried pot but famously didn't inhale, Clinton's answer to the personal experience question is no. While I'm sure there was quite a bit around Wellesley by the time she graduated in 1969, the straight-laced Hillary Rodham did not partake, and I doubt anyone disbelieves her. But on the policy issue, she has been far less clear. Her position is that medical marijuana should be available for people in extreme medical conditions. As for recreational availability, she has said that we should wait to see how things go in the states that have legalized it and then make a judgment, which is a reasonable position to take. That said, the issue will undoubtedly come up in the campaign, since there are questions about federal policy, even if all the legalization happens at the state level, and she's going to be pressed to get more specific. Should marijuana still be classified as a federal government as Schedule I controlled substance, meaning it's treated the same as cocaine and heroin? Should the VA doctors be allowed to prescribe it to veterans? On Thursday, the Senate Appropriations Committee passed an amendment prohibiting the Treasury Department from punishing banks that do business with marijuana establishments in states where they're operating legally. The lack of access to banks' services has been a huge problem for marijuana-related businesses. If that's something Clinton supports, that kind of instructions, what kind of instructions would she give to the Justice Department about how to operate its states where marijuana has been legalized? Chances are that some, if not all, of the legalization initiatives on the ballot next year will pass, and others will be coming in future elections. That means more and more Americans will be living in states where marijuana use is legal by state law, but still illegal under federal law. So this question of how the federal government approaches that conflict will become more acute. It's safe to say that the next Republican administration will maintain the status quo and even reverse the tentative moves the Obama administration has made to loosen some restrictions. But Clinton is going to have to say, I don't know why, I guess the B threw me off, is going to have to say how she'd approach the issue. You know what? As a matter of fact, that mistake might be something I'm thinking in the back of my mind. Why not have Bill come the fuck back out? Get his ass out there. He's the one who should be saying shit. He's the one that made the initial denial. Get your ass to Colorado, son, and get your ass into one of those marijuana bars and sit down and talk to those Americans next to a dabbing rig. I want to see that. I want to see some grown-up behavior here, and to stop treating us like we are sitting at the kiddie table at Thanksgiving. It's time for this to stop. I am done with us being in the back of the bus. Let's go. All right? Hillary may not be the appropriate person to do this, but Bill is excellent. I don't need him to take a hit off a joint, but I need him to get his ass over there and find out what's really going the F on. Then he can speak for Hillary. And with legalization becoming more popular, particularly in her party, don't be surprised if Clinton begins to slowly evolve a slow evolution in a more liberal direction on this issue, and she has on many others. I think your initial problem is really Bill. Bill was the one who lied. Bill, come on, man. I saw you playing bongos and smoking a cigar, but marijuana just wasn't your thing. Rightio, but you're the kind of guy that would have hung out with stoners. You're the kind of guy that wouldn't have minded that. And you've been brushing it. So you need to get over there and show some respect so other people can do it too. You know? I think Bill is the original problem right there, where he went, yes, I tried, but... That needs to be fixed. Marijuana industry to get a financial boost. Despite shifting public perception and legalization efforts, what are we doing? I don't... No. No. How do I make it go away? How do I make it go away? I don't want spots secured. I want it... There it is. They're hiding the X. Oh my god, it makes you go to the freaking thing. Can you believe this? Can you believe this? This is probably some kind of evil trap, too. Oh, what a terrible... Oh my god. Oh my god, it's all over my page. Go away, you crazy stupidness. Okay. However, marijuana supporters received a major victory this week after the U.S. Senate approved a measure that will make it easier for marijuana businesses to engage with banks, all cash. At the moment, small business owners whose firms are dealing in marijuana struggle to secure loans and even open a bank account, as banks are bound by federal law, which still classes marijuana as illegal. Simple daily operations like payroll are made difficult for cannabis firms. For that reason, the marijuana industry has become a risky one due to the high volume of cash that dispensaries keep on hand. Excuse me. Easing regulations. The new measures will relax some of the laws that make it illegal for banks to handle money generated by marijuana sales under the new rules. Banks can engage with pot-based firms without worrying about federal mandates. Times are changing. The decision to pass an amendment represents a shifting tide in Washington, where marijuana, you know why the tide is shifting? Because the wave is coming. That's not the tide shifting, that's the tide pulling out and the fish flapping on the shore of Washington. That's what's happening. And I'm riding that wave. It's a tsunami. Shifting tide? No. More like tide receding and then wah! Where lawmakers have been hesitant to take a stand on marijuana. However, now they're waxing up their boards. Sorry. The issue has gained traction among voters and will eventually need to be addressed by the nation's policymakers. Yeah, they're waxing up their boards. You know, you're the shore that this wave crashes on. Ah. You had your chance when it passed through your state. Should have started paddling in then. Catching a wave is hard. Regulating marijuana. This is Fox and Hounds. I don't know what that is. I don't think it's Fox News. It's something else. In all likelihood, California voters will be asked to decide the legal status of marijuana on the 2016 ballot. Advocates of legalization are hoping to build on the momentum in four states, Alaska, Colorado, Oregon, and Washington, and the District of Columbia, that made the recreational use of marijuana legal. Two national advocacy organizations, the Drug Policy Alliance and the Marijuana Policy Project, have made California a major focus for their 2016 election year. Will a legalization initiative pass in California? Our May PPIC survey suggests that support is relatively high among likely voters. 56% said that marijuana should be legal. When we first began asking about legalization in May 2010, California voters were sharply divided. While support for marijuana legalization has fluctuated since March 2014, we have seen an incremental trend towards support for legalization among likely voters. Among likely voters today, majorities of Democrats, independents, young voters, and parents favor legalization. That's the important one. Parents. That's what got us in 2010 in California. Parents, moms, soccer moms that were afraid that, but more kids will try it, which is, that is just utter reefer madness bullshit. And it took us this long to get through to those ladies. Ladies, you need to stop letting people tell you fancy stories. Stand up for yourself. Among likely voters today, majorities of Democrats, independents, young voters, and parents favor legalization. However, among some key electoral groups, including Latinos, Republicans, and older voters, legalization fails to get majority support. The success of any initiative aimed at legalizing the recreational use of marijuana is likely to depend on whether supporters can make inroads among these groups. Well, let me give you a little hint. When Gavin Newsom came out with his Blue Ribbon Report in California about how marijuana and why marijuana should be regulated and legalized in the state for recreational use, his main goal was to say the violence in Mexico. The violence in Mexico. We're going to get the Latino vote. Because that's what we're trying to do, is save their families. Save their country from this insane prohibition that is ripping it to pieces. It's too much money in it. You gotta take the money out of it. You know, you gotta take it away from all the bad people and not let them do this. Because look at how much power they have. It's too much. It's created an imbalance, you know? We will get those votes. Would marijuana legalization be good public policy? That is an even more difficult question. This week, a Blue Ribbon Commission on Marijuana Policy, chaired by Lieutenant Governor Gavin Newsom, made a series of recommendations to consider in crafting an initiative. The list includes ways to limit children's access, reduce illegal activity, and regulate sales. Should an initiative pass, a significant degree of implementing legislation and regulation are likely to follow. In short, the devil is in the details. But they said they are also going to create a plan that would unwind over several years, not all at once. So that way they could craft it carefully as they went, instead of having the lid come off the champagne bottle too fast, which is what Washington is in danger of having happen to them. Those aren't changing tides, guys. Okay? You're out collecting fish and seashells, and the tsunami's coming. Wake up. Would marijuana legalization be good public policy? That is an even more, okay, read that. Should an initiative pass, read that, these details may not only determine whether legalization is good public policy, they may also affect the electoral fortune of any marijuana legalization initiative in 2016's ballot. In our March 2015 survey, Republicans, 51% of Latino, or 51% of Republicans and Latinos, 56%, likely voters were among the most likely to say they would be bothered if a store selling marijuana opened up in their neighborhood. Similarly, in our May 2015 survey, Republicans 58% and Latinos 55% likely voters were among the most likely to say that they are very concerned about more underage people trying. That's the one. See, that's where their head's at. Okay. So, in other words, they're 5 years behind where we're at. You know, the Vatican could so help us out on this. If the Pope would just, like, seriously help us stop the violence, that would be so awesome. And stop helping pharmaceutical companies with a just say no policy. That would be so awesome. And help California legalize, because we can help save Mexico. Okay? We're already starting to really hurt their cartels. Once we start to legalize other drugs and make it a more of a health issue and medical concern instead of a law enforcement concern, then things will start to become sane again. Insane laws create an insane reality. All right. They are concerned about more underage people trying the marijuana. The details of regulation and implementation are likely to play an important role in addressing some of these voter concerns. Especially when he says, you know, we're not here to raise taxes. We're here to stop this from happening. We're here to try to change the laws and craft the laws so that it stops creating this culture in which these violent crimes can exist, these violent gangs can exist. You're feeding them. Just like with the mobs during, you know, Prohibition, we literally are living that mob experience in California. I don't know what's going on across the other states, but we need to legalize because we need to get rid of Al Capone here. El Chapo. We need to get rid of people like that. And I'm sorry, but Prohibition just ain't getting it done, period. In the coming months, PPIC plans to contribute to the discussion surrounding the legal status of marijuana in the state, as also our aim will be to provide essential information and help frame the debate by identifying some of the key issues that states will have to address. We hope to help policymakers, ultimately the voters, improve California's marijuana policies. Yeah, and guide the world. Insanity. Flippin', let's go back to where we have sanity. Researchers harvest first crop from industrial hemp fields, field study. Okay, this is Hawaii. Very good video, too. This guy even talks about hempcrete. And I mean, hempcrete's gonna, when Americans find out about hempcrete, that's when the wave's gonna crash on you. When they find out that a robot can print their house out of hempcrete in like 3 days, oh my god. Things are going to rupture. Rupture. You're paying attention to marijuana. You should be paying attention to hemp, because hemp is the real goal in this battle. We can change a lot of industries with hemp. And I'm sorry, jobs are going to change. But imagine you're a construction worker and now there's a whole bunch of building materials that are new that are going to make your job easier and better. And kind of more interesting and solve problems for you. Work began Thursday to harvest the first crop from the University of Hawaii's Industrial Hemp Research Project. The field is located in Waimanola, I can't say the Hawaiian word, and housed three varieties of industrial hemp: temperate zone hemp, tropical seed hemp, and tropical fiber hemp. Initial findings from the project indicate that the tropical fiber hemp is flourishing and has grown over 10 feet tall during the crop cycle of 15 weeks. The tropical seed hemp is much shorter, but is heavily producing seeds. Meanwhile, the temperature zone hemp flowered and died after 8 weeks. Rep. Cynthia Fellin, R. Kilauea, Kanoa Bay, okay, I did my best on that, who helped lead the hemp farming movement in Hawaii, said it's been a challenge to ease the state's restrictions on hemp growing. Hemp is not a drug. Hemp is an agricultural crop that will keep our agricultural land and active production provide a product for entrepreneurs, she said. We'll be able to build our houses out of hempcrete and not import those materials. Think about that. Hempcrete. I'll put a link. I'll make a note. I've put links to hempcrete many times before. Once you find out what hempcrete is, it's like, holy cow. And, okay, printing houses, I'll do two. Okay, so there's two different technologies. There's the technology that they would like to use when we try to populate places like Mars, which is we send a little robot, a couple of little robots, and the little robots, start on one end of the building, and they start farting out, pooping out concrete or something like that, right? And they build a house. And they build the walls, right? And they build the walls. And then when they need to start on another part, they go build that part, right? And they work constantly. They don't need breaks. They don't have unions. They don't get tired. They don't get sick. And they show up to work every single day, okay? Hempcrete is a material that they could build buildings out of. And that is a mixture of lime and the pulpy material that is found inside, the fibrous material that's found inside the hemp stalk. Once you take off the fiber, that stuff that most people would throw away, the center that's so easily broken up, you couldn't make like a hiking stick out of it or a bow or something. It's not appropriate for any of those things, but it's kind of like straw. So once you put it in the lime, it's very much like building your own mortar bricks, okay? It's like mortar, right? It's like building your own bricks with straw, except it's lime and this hempcrete stuff. And hemp grows so fast that you could easily produce way more hemp than have to worry about getting trees from Northern California to build houses in Hawaii. That is going to be the real big change that this, I'm telling you, this is a disruptive technology. Marijuana, and people don't want to recognize it because they have their heads in the wrong place, is a disruptive technology. And it's good. It's here. Thank God. We're going to change things and make them better. Great thing about hempcrete is it's like adobe, and it turns to stone, and it locks the fibers in, and the fibers actually will, like, petrify, I guess. But it basically turns to stone. Okay, so there's two things that are excellent about hempcrete. Hemp is a carbon-neutral plant that will suck carbon, which is causing global warming, out of the air. And when you lock it into the concrete, it's there forever. It's there for as long as the concrete exists. So you've literally taken carbon out of the air and locked it into stone and helped to save our environment by building a house. By printing a house. OK, Okay, the other good thing is, because it's very much like Adobe, it breathes. You don't have to spend as much on air conditioning and stuff like this and heating, because it holds in the heat, it keeps the house cool, it doesn't hold moisture in the wall, so you don't have to worry as many as at walls like on a regular house. They have pockets in the wall, you know, and things get in there. This has no pockets like Adobe. It's just a solid rock, you know. The other thing is, you can make any flippin' shape you want. There's no limitation when you're pooping out, when you got a robot pooping out concrete that's made from hemp. You can just make any kind of shape you want to live in. There's no limitation except for, you know, you have to go by the laws of physics. But there's no limitation about what kind of a house you could build or what shape. From what I've seen of hempcrete, I could not espouse it higher. It looks amazing. I certainly would consider it for a feature home for myself if it was more readily available, and I hope it will be. Okay. Hemp is not a drug. Hemp is an agricultural crop that will keep our agricultural land in active production, provide a product for entrepreneurs, she said, we'll be able to build our houses out of hemp, create, and not import those materials. The project has made possible the By Hawaii Act 56, which allowed industrial hemp to be grown as a state at the State University Research Initiative. Okay. Unlike marijuana, hemp has a very low THC. It's not going to get you high. You can smoke it for days. You're going to get a headache. Don't smoke that. That's actually not going to help you. But hemp does have CBD, I think. And the CBD can actually be very useful. And it doesn't get you high, but it may help, you know, heal your broken bone or something is what I'm hearing. Content. Okay, THC content, which is the active component that makes people feel high. Yeah, THC. And THC doesn't actually exist in marijuana. THCA exists in marijuana. THC only exists when you heat marijuana up to like 250 degrees. Then the THC, look at, see my shirt? Then the THC releases the A molecule and it becomes THC. That's why everybody has to heat it up. See? Otherwise, you're just eating vegetables or smoking vegetables. Experts say, once you heat it up, but otherwise, it's just vegetables. Experts say today's U.S. market for hemp, seed oil, and fiber is approximately $600 million a year. And once people see, once you could see that you can make plastics out of this, and, you know, here's your plastic that you can feed into your printer that will be renewable and will be good for the environment. Here it is. Here it is. I mean, here it is. Okay. Take this off. How long was that? Oh, that was an hour. That was good. I hope the audio worked properly. I don't know, man. Day to day. I don't know what I'm getting day to day with this thing. It's just, who knows? And I'm going to try to make these little buds that my husband bought for me last. I have to get till at least the 8th. That will be very difficult this weekend. So a lot of interesting stories, and most of them said what I'm saying, okay? They know what's happening in Washington. You heard them. They said, the tide is changing, right? No, the tide is not changing. The tide is pulling out, and fish are flopping, and you're seeing coral reefs, and you're like, that's unusual. The tide doesn't usually pull out this far. What could this possibly mean? It means something's coming. Get off the beach or grab a board, one or the other. Something big is coming. And I want, you know, all my stoners in Canada to hear this. I don't care what your government's saying. I don't care what that, you know, whatever that conservative dude up there saying, blah, blah, blah. He's just shooting out his face and passing laws. We're the ones who tell the UN what to do. I'm sorry. We're always the bad guys. So here's what the bad guy has to say. If we tell the UN what to do, then this is happening, because this is happening here. And that's all there is to it, you know? And it's ridiculous, and it'll help a lot of people, and it'll make a lot of opportunities for people to make money. And it'll end a ridiculous law that was made by a racist person, you know, and you know, pushed with lies and misrepresentations, and help us all to regain sanity. And so that we could look our children in the face when we tell them not to do things, instead of, well, because I said, no more of that. I've seen too many parents go through that in the last 30 years. You're putting all of us in a ridiculous position. We don't want to carry your pail of water anymore. You know? Carry your own damn pail. And that's what I have to say about it. But I definitely want stoners to realize, no, things are moving along very nicely. Really, walls are falling. And here in California and in my locality, I mean, I can feel it. I can really feel it. It's for reals. Another neat thing that's happening is that all of our police force here in Ventura County is going to be wearing those cameras on their chests now. You know, they ran a pilot program. And they decided that it worked pretty good. And I saw a couple of police officers with them on there. And now they're going to put them on all the police officers. And I think that's really a good thing, because that will help protect them too. I've known people that were in situations on a job as some sort of security. And I worked for security other than the school district, okay? And cameras can really save your reputation. Because people are not sure what happens, and other people can say a lot of things that may not necessarily be true about what you did or what they saw, or they're mistaken. And cameras can really clarify what happened and make things better, you know. However, if they're just going to record all this information and not make it public knowledge, that's going to be a problem. That's just going to, you're going to have to make it be something accessible that we could trust. It has to be data that we can trust. And if you start, I'm not saying my locality will do it in Ventura, but don't, you know, not letting us know what the police are doing is a bad policy. That makes us suspicious. You know, it's just bad policy. I don't really want to be suspicious of law enforcement. And lately, oh my gosh, the news is so hectic with it. And there just seems to be so many reasons. That poor lady in Texas, you know, they got murdered. I mean, and everybody's just desperately trying to, you know, she had marijuana in her system and used the old marijuana slur against her, you know. Just, it doesn't work anymore. That's for one thing. At least it doesn't work here. And I argued about it with Trayvon Martin. I mean, I was in there on Twitter arguing with fools about this hour after hour, and I'm done. It's done, okay? There are racists, okay? There are crooked police officers. There are corrupt officials in government. These things need to be taken care of like any other crime. There are bad people that are poor. There are bad people that are of color or women or whatever. And we should deal with that like a crime and investigate it, not just jump on someone because of their color and beat them in the face. Okay? I would really like to see police officers actually do investigation. I don't know. It would be just so nice to see that. Running in and beating people in the face because of what color they are is just not making me feel good, you know? I don't know what to do for you. And then you're going to call me and you're going to say, hey, we need a donation, or we need your support, or there's going to be a vote to help you with funding or something like that. And how am I supposed to feel after all this news? Really? So you're putting people that just want to try to figure out what's going on in a terrible position. The cameras, I think, will really help. I think more police officers that allow that to happen and stop, you know, worrying and protecting themselves unless there's a reason, you know, then I think the better the public, the relationship you're going to have with the public is. But the more you're like creepy and all like dressed like Darth Vader, the more I just, how am I supposed to support you, yo? The cameras make me feel good. I feel better knowing it's not perfect, but at least they're trying, you know. So you got to give them credit, a little bit of credit. Here, before I go, at 60 minutes, I'll show you one of these silly bongs I made. This one does not have a pull-out stem. It's kind of freezing. This is like this blown glass vase I found at the thrift store. Let's load her up. I just have so much fun making these little things. They're fun. It's like a craft project. Go to Michael's and look through their vases. They're all painted, though. You notice all the vases that you buy nowadays are all got stupid crappy paint in them. They don't actually use colored glass anymore. It's like after the Depression era or something, 1950s. I was thinking about putting like a little carb hole, but then I thought it's a volume. It's just not big enough to care. I could just, and the smoke will come out. That would just make something where the water comes out and spills on your desk. And it's so cute, just like that. It reminds me of a little rum bottle from Pirates of the Caribbean or something. I can't remember. Those old rum bottles actually have a name. And they're very rare. They're very strange shape. I think it's called an onion bottle. Oh, that's it. I think it's called an onion bottle. But I'm not sure. I like to collect glass. I'm fascinated by the history of glass. Here I have a bottle that was manufactured soon after Prohibition ended. And on this bottle, at the top, it says, "Federal law forbids sale or reuse of this bottle." And that's because after Prohibition, people were worried that the mobsters were going to take the bottles that the government stores, because only government stores were allowed to sell alcohol, okay, right after Prohibition, till regular stores could be set up with legitimate distributors. So they were concerned that the mobsters would take the bottles, and after you drank the alcohol, they'd refill them and resell them as government, you know, alcohol. So they figured that having this label was going to be a huge deterrent, I guess, to that. But this is a relic of Prohibition. And they're not worth very much, but you can still find them. And I just like, in general, medicine bottles and stuff are cool. Yeah, there's lots of all kinds of old Tabasco bottles and stuff that are made of. A lot of people kind of have a hobby of digging up bottles, and then you find them like at swap meets and antique stores, and I just end up attracted to them. I'm like, oh, look at that one. That one's cool. This is neat. I wonder what this is for. Most of these, I think, were for, what the heck did they used to give kids when they were sick? It's either fish oil of some kind, or it's like that medication they would give kids when they were sick they didn't like. Castor oil. A lot of these things are that kind of stuff. They didn't have a lot of medications they could turn to back then, see. This is the old medicine bottles. Real old. So I dig the bottles. I think they're cool. Stick them in my window. Alright, that's enough bullshit. That's enough rambling bullshit right there. Well, when you are making bongs and stuff, be careful what glass and everything or bottles you're buying at a thrift store, antique store. Some of it might be something. So take a look at the bottom, you know. Look at markings. Look at how the bottle was made. Because modern bottles are made in a machine that just kind of prints them out, right? Like, see? You can see at the bottom there, just kind of, and they're done. Okay. Old bottles will have a funky bottom. Let's see if this one is. Yeah. This one's kind of funky. See, they'll have all kinds of weird circles and things in the bottom. Things that are blown glass will have weird circles. And the more it looks like it's two or three pieces of glass that's been welded together, the older the bottle is. Because that shows you the manufacturing process and how, you know, how it changed. I'm not sure how old this one is. My mom gave me some of these. Don't seem to have any really old examples here. Within reach. Oh, wait. Sweet baby. Yeah, that one. Here's a good one to show you. This is off topic, but hey, education time. These are my other interests. Okay, so here at the bottom of this, right, you can see, come on you, that the glass has been welded together in three pieces. The bottom is one piece, the circle in the center, and then these two pieces of glass here. And that tells you how old the bottle is. So you look for markings on the bottom and stuff, and you can, they're not worth a lot of money, but they're sure fun to research. And glass in general is just a fascinating subject. You have glass on your, you know, on your computer, your laptop, or your tablet, or your phone, and some of it you can swipe the glass, and glass is an amazing thing. It's just really interesting. We didn't always have glass that you could put in your oven, you know, that was something that came along. I was telling my son, Pyrex got into making baking ware. I heard, I know I told this story, but they started making baking ware because this guy's wife that worked there at the plant said, hey, why don't you make me a baking dish? And so he took something that was kind of a big, thing, glass piece like this, right? And he cut it in half, and then he took the two halves and he put them together, so it kind of made a really crappy baking dish. And all of her girlfriends loved it. And they all wanted one, I guess, is the way I heard the story. And then the company heard about it, and that's how Pyrex started making our baking glass. This is a story I heard. most glass is not valuable, even depression-era glass, but be careful what you're drilling into. You don't know when it was made, what it was made of, you know, so it might be valuable, and you're ruining it, you know, you're ruining the value. But making these little bongs is sure fun. I got this piece, this bong, the water, and the bottle part, right, for like 69 cents, right? And it's blown glass, you can tell at the bottom. Boop. Come on, show the thing. Once it freeze. So you can tell by the bottom it's blown glass. It's got a really cool spiral. It's green. Feels so neat in the hand. And my son said he's really liking, and I have to agree with him. I wanted to talk about this. He likes this. He likes this top part because the new bong he just got out of the 420 box, that oil, you know, toxic oil can, that also has this sort of, and I told him, I think what I like about it is it feels like a kiss. Because it's like, it feels good against your, instead of that, the edge that, you know, it's flat. So it just feels better. I like this surface better. It feels like a kiss, like you're kissing something. So anyway, that's enough babble from me. Thank you for joining me on this episode, and I hope the audio worked out, and those were pretty interesting stories, and have a great weekend. Don't forget Freddie Pritchard's show. Let me see, was there? Oh, yes. And I want to make sure to link to Jane Drow and Soundrone did their Stop, Drop, and Glob. And you gotta watch that. That's great. I really enjoyed that. That was awesome. So I'll link to those, and you have a good weekend, and you stay high, and goodbye.